call is that you must open that door. You must make up your mind to let him in. You must open, remove the barrier. What is it that makes a man not want to open door for a visitor? Number one is ignorance. Can you open door for someone you do not know? If I come to your house for the first time, and I knock, bop, 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 and you look at the door, you will ask me, who are you? Would you ask that question? In fact, some parents go as far as teaching their children, come, sit down. Don't open door for any stranger. Don't talk to strangers you don't know. Have you not had people do it? Why do they do it? Because they want to know. That is why the Bible says, seek ye first. Research. Find out who he is. He doesn't just come for the sake of coming. He wants you to know who he is. He wants you to open the door with a deep knowledge of who you are opening the door for. If you go to the hospital and they want to operate upon you, no doctor will put scissors or whatever in your body to tear your body without your consent. Have you seen it happen before? Even if you're unconscious, they will seek out for someone closer to you to give approval. And they don't just, what they are looking for is not yes, open. That's not what they are looking for. What the doctor is seeking out for is what they call informed consent. If he opens your body without your consent, not just anyhow consent, I want to do your operation, though, if I don't do you, that is not the kind of consent he's seeking for. He will tell you, this is your chances of survival. If you do this operation, there is 60% chance you will survive. There is 40% chance you will die. A lot of people have done this and they have died. Look at what you do. Look at the side effects and the consequences if you do this. You might not eat this kind of food. You might not stress yourself again. This is the information he must give you. It is after giving you that information, he will not give you form. He says, should we go on and operate? When you are saying yes, you are not saying yes because you don't understand. You are saying yes because you have made up your mind based on the information you have. So when Jesus is knocking at your door, he's not saying, just come and open for the sake of opening. He said, before you open that door, know who I am. I am your savior. I am the man who carries your supply to you. I am the man who wants to reconcile you back to your father. I am the man who says, I no longer treat you as a slave. I treat you as a what? As a friend. And when I am coming, I carry a meal of friendship. Because when I step in and you allow me to come in, if you understand who I am and I come in, that meal I'm carrying is your supernatural supply. So we'll share a meal as a friend. Because there is something that makes a friend a friend. A friend is a man who understands you. A friend is a man who knows your weaknesses. A friend is a man who knows when you have and when you don't have. In that same Proverbs, we say brothers are meant for adversity. Why did God not place us as brothers? After all, he said we are God's people. He said no. If he place us as brothers, we'll be looking at our weaknesses and give us appropriately. Because brothers are meant for adversity. That is the word of God. It does not change. But as a friend, he has no option but to love you at all times. Do you want to succeed in life? Come to God. Do you want to grow in your business? Allow God to be a part of that business as a friend. Do you want to succeed in any of your endeavors? Make God the head of that business. In your relationship, do you want it to be smooth without problem? Bring God in first. In your time of decision making, just ask your friend, say, I am with you always. I stand beside you always, even to the ends of the world. He is always there waiting for just to communicate with you. One thing that kills relationship more than anything is lack of communication. He's there. If you check, there's a man at your door, and he's knocking. I told you to open the book of John 13, verse 25. Are we all there? Let me just read it, then I'll summarize. From 25 to 27. Look at what Jesus said. Leaning towards Jesus, he asked, Lord, who is it? Jesus said, it is the one to whom I give the bread dipped in the sauce. And when he had dipped it, he gave it to Judas, son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas had eaten, the others at the temple knew that what Jesus meant. Since Judas was their treasurer, some thought Jesus was telling him to go and pay for the food or to give some money to the poor. So Judas left at once, going out into the night. In Luke, when Jesus was talking to the woman at that water, at the place where they draw water, the well, the Samaritan woman, when the woman ran away, having heard who it is and opened the door, the Bible says she ran into the town and started shouting, "Come and see the man who has told me how I am. He has revealed everything about me. He must be the Savior and the Messiah." People came and they asked, "Where is the bread? Give us the bread that you gave to her that has turned her life upside down." Jesus said, "I am the bread of what? Life. I am standing in your presence, yet you do not believe me, even though you are seeing me." When he came to selling out Jesus, he did something. He knew who would sell him out. Yet, he had room for him to repent. When a friend gets to know that you are about to betray him, he doesn't still call you as an enemy because he's already under a bondage to love you at all times. Are you understanding what I'm saying? But go and betray a brother, it takes heaven to reconcile two of you. Two of us. Betray a brother, a blood, it takes heaven. Generational enmity are not as a result of friendship broken. Generational enmity as a result of brotherhood blood that is broken. But the fact that Judas betrayed Jesus never meant he was angry against the world. He told him and told everybody around. It was the decision that Judas took that dealt with him. As for Jesus, he knew he would do it. Before he did it, he prophesied about it. After prophesying, he forgave as a friend. But the man who did it could not forgive himself when he saw what happened to his friend. You know why? When he did it, he was not looking at what would happen to his friend. He was thinking it was mere arrest. But when he now saw what they were doing to his friend, his conscience pricked him. He could not hold it. Because the bond of friendship began to ask questions. How many times have you betrayed Jesus? Have you judaized him as Judas Iscariot? Have you dealt with him a serious blow? He forgives at all times. Let me shock you. Jesus said, "Even though your sin is as black as scarlet, come. We'll do what? We'll reason together. If it's as red as crimson, come, I will make it as white as what? Snow." What is he talking about? It doesn't matter the level of betrayal you have given him as a friend. I am still loving. It doesn't matter the kind of sin you think that God cannot forgive. I am still loving. My friendship with you is not now. It can only end on death. As long as you are alive and you are still breathing, the grace of salvation keeps on knocking at your door. It is never too late to accept. Do you know that the man at the tree with Jesus, that arm robber who sat, this one was by the right, one was by the left, they were at the point of death. Right there, salvation was still speaking. Jesus said, "Today I remember you in my life, I remember you in my paradise." The other one made decision to die. He died. But right there at the cross, he was still knocking. And there was a man that answered. If there is a man that can confess his sin this morning, there is a God that can forgive and supply. If there is a man that can say, "God, I have sinned against you. I have gone contrary to your ways. I assure you there is a God who is willing to forgive, not just forgive, rehabilitate you, not just rehabilitate you, supply you all you need for you to succeed in life." If there is a man that can say, "God, is it possible for someone like me to come back?" There is a friend that is saying, "Yes. I can restore you back to all that you have lost. Everything that sin has taken away from you, by mere believing, I will revive it." Have you joined cultism? And you don't know how to come out again? Say, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man. Say, the end thereof is what? Death. Have you soiled your hand in blood? And you think that God cannot forgive? It's a lie. He has already bought you with his own blood. The blood has speaking better thing than the blood of Abel. Has already brought salvation for you. All he wants is for you to believe in him. When you accept him as your Lord and personal Savior, irrespective of the manner of sin that you have done, and you confess him as your Lord and personal Savior, he said, I will forgive your sin. When I forgive your sin, I will restore you back. When I restore you back, I will rehabilitate you. When I rehabilitate you, I will supply all that you need to succeed in life. Some say healing is the inheritance of the children of God, but yet we are in sickness. You know the word children of God, as simple as it is, do you know it has deep meaning? We are children of God. Are you a child of God? I am a child of God. And if we are able to run away, it's a lifestyle. You cannot be the child of a man who you don't know. You cannot be the child of a man who you have constantly kept outside the door of your house. He gives on nothing, my son, I want to come. He gives on nothing, because you feel that if he comes in, if you read that scripture very well, when Jesus came in, he did not condemn. He said, if I come in, I have not come to condemn you. If I come in, I have not come to call you my enemy. Because even before you open the door, you must have repented. Are you understanding what I'm saying? He said, when I come in, I will die with you. We will eat a friendly meal. What is a friendly meal? Is it a meal of condemnation? Is it a meal that keeps on saying, you shall die, you shall die? Jesus has said, I have come that you may not die. I have come so that you will have life. And have it what? More abundantly. Let the church rise. Will you open the door for me? We are lying to continue looking to eternity. I know we are all children of God. But there's something that Job used to do. And each time I look at it and I read about Job in the scripture, I find out the reason why he keeps on dedicating himself back to God. Every morning, Job will lay hands on all his children and he will begin to rededicate them back to God. In the evening, he will do it and he will say, Papa, who knows? When they went out, they may have, as a result of peer pressure, they may have said one thing or the other by their speaking. They may have offended you. By their perception of their eyes, they may have sinned against you. By the thought of their heart, Papa, who knows? But I dedicate them to you. As a church, we are going to dedicate ourselves to God. We are going to say to God, in any way we have come short of your glory, may your friendship never elude us. If you have not accepted Jesus as the Lord and personal Savior, this is the best opportunity to do that. Because it will be a very, very big disappointment, not just to God, but to you. If this month of supernatural blessing will pass without you accepting the man who carries the basket of blessings. If you want to dedicate your life back to God, if you want to come and dedicate yourself again and say to God, renew the spirit within me, this is an opportunity for you. And if you have not given your life, there are two sets of persons I'm calling. Just two sets. Those who have repented, yes, you have repented. But you want to dedicate yourself again back to God, you can take a step of faith outside. If you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, and you have not done it before, or maybe you have done it, you have lived in sin before now, and you don't know whether you are still standing in the faith, there is a window of opportunity here for you. Dedicating yourself to God is not a sin. It's a normal thing we do for relationship. God is seeking for relationship. He's not seeking to condemn you. That is not why he came. He said, I have come that you may have life. He didn't come so that you will die in sin. He comes so that he will heal you and bring you out of sin. So if you want to dedicate yourself and get back to God, please take a step of faith. Rededicating yourself to God is not a sin. It's a show of love for your friend. I want you to begin to talk to God this morning where you are. inside and dance with me. Come inside and live with me. Come inside and dwell with me. Come inside and be my friend and love me at all times. Come with your supernatural supply.
Yeah. Everything I need. Thank you.